All right, good afternoon. I have to say that I've never been an activist before. I'm more of an academic sociologist. So what I'm doing today is just basically to share the findings that we did together with Wing Chong and Jack, and of course, Brema was also in the team. I also have to say that I had a bout of flu recently, so if I find I sound a lot more sexy, it's unintentional, okay? Purely, yeah. Okay, so I have several slides to show you, and I'll go through each one of them. And feel free to stop me anytime if you want to, all right? So let me see, okay. So these are the findings from the Singapore survey. What should I do? How does it work? This one here, right? Which one? I'm one who needs a mouse, I think. All right, so just to reassure you that actually we are, this is a legit kind of survey, right? We did this during the period April 9 to May 31st last year, and we had a sample size of 1,500, and of course, age 18 to 74. We did an oversampling of Malays and Indians and have it weighted up, because if you only do, if you weigh according to, if you don't weigh a sort of oversample, you're going to end up with a very small sample of Malays and Indians, right? So, the fourth point is based on the random survey of addresses purchased from the Department of Statistics. So we try to be random in the statistical sense as much as possible. Are you doing it for me? Okay, wonderful. Go ahead. All right. So there are six major topics that we are doing, right? So interest and knowledge of about death penalty, support for death penalty, general and specific, and then mandatory and discretionary, and also what if there are compelling reasons against the death penalty, and number four, we use Roger Hood's questionnaire, where he we asked the respondents like 12 scenario cases and asked them to decide what sentence they would give for those cases. In those 12 scenario cases, there are mitigating and aggravating factors, and also to what extent do respondents differ from the judges. The assumption here is that the judges would sentence every of these cases to death, right? But what would the respondents say? How would they sentence them, given the factors that are shared, all right, in the questionnaire. Number five is perceived effective alternative measures for reducing violent crimes leading to death and for drug trafficking. So for example, should it be education? Should it be something milder besides the death penalty? And number six is I did a regression analysis, all right, for support for death penalty by some demographics, like in terms of education, in terms of religion, and in terms of age, all right? And I think there's some interesting findings there. Next slide, please. Okay, the first one is about interest and knowledge. So maybe I'll just go to the numbers rather than next one. Okay, so this is the kind of figures I get, all right? The proportion who indicated that they are interested and concerned about the death penalty is actually 50% out of our sample of 1,005. And presumably, this is representative of the Singapore population, age 18 to 74. And also, another indicator of interest is whether they talk with other people about death penalty frequently. And actually, it's not many, all right, 15% of the sample. What about indicators of knowledge? 39% say that they know something about the issue, all right? And the last row here is we ask people whether how many people were sentenced to death, right, over the last 10 years, and we get all kinds of numbers. According to Wing Chong, the actual number is actually 32, right, over the last 10 years. But we get all kinds of funny answers. In fact, there are people who say that there were like 60,000 death sentences in the last 10 years, which of course is ridiculous, right? The actual number is only 32. I'm not saying that it's too little, but it's 32, all right? So question here is, what if they were more interested? What would happen? So, but what I found, this is something quite strange, right? Those who say that they're interested and concerned about the death penalty tend to be more supportive of the death penalty. So I'm wondering whether are they the one who just sort of check out YouTube, read out internet articles, whether to see whether they support their point of view or not, rather than go in to see whether is there anything that is against the death penalty, all right? Arguments against the death penalty. And what if they were more informed? Those who say they are well informed are also more likely to support the death penalty. I mean, this is really strange, right? It's kind of paradoxical, right? People who are interested, people who think they are well informed, they tend to be more supportive of the death penalty. So I think it's really people who are looking for views that are consistent with their own. That seems to be the case. Next one, please. All right, we asked a very broad question, right? Support for the death penalty in general. And we found that the proportion who support or strongly support is 70%, okay? And this is actually not very far different from that of a recent Rich survey that indicated that it was about 80% who support the death penalty. But I have to say that this is a very broad question. We just asked them, do you support or not? That's all. All right, so strongly support, support, don't support, or not supporting at all. All right. So, but you also, also want to highlight that actually strongly support is only 8%. 62% support, but not didn't indicate that it's strongly support. Next, please. Okay, how about support for mandatory or discretionary sentence? So we asked, you know, the three crimes that are out there, right? Murder, intentional murder, drug trafficking, and firearms offenses. The support for death penalty for each one of these is 92, 86, and 88. All right, here we are a lot more specific. Remember earlier is broadly speaking, general, 70%. But when it comes to very specific items like murder, drug trafficking, and firearms offense, it's 92 for murder, drug trafficking, 86, and then for firearms offenses, it's 88. You notice that broadly, I mean, generally speaking, you find that people are more likely to indicate to support the death penalty for murder, but less so for drug trafficking. Right? You can see that there's some differences between the different types of crime. Okay, let's look at the details, right? 47 plus 45, of course, adds to 92, right? All right, so of these 92, 47% support the mandatory death penalty, and then 45% support discretionary death penalty, okay? So what we see here is that actually, if you mandatory minus discretionary is actually plus two. So in a way, there are a lot more people supporting mandatory. I mean, it's just 2%. And what about drug trafficking? Again, you find support for mandatory death penalty is 32, much less, but discretionary is 54. All right, so more people are for discretionary rather than for mandatory death sentence. Similarly, for firearms offense, you notice that it's 52 and 36. Again, they are more for discretionary rather than mandatory. All right, can you see the pattern there? I know it's not very sharp contrast, but I think for these two, it's quite sharp. For the one on murder, it's actually almost the same, 47 and 45. Okay, so when you ask people what are the top reasons for supporting the death penalty, the one that keeps coming out is deterrent effect. All right, I think the respondent believe that, you know, death penalty is necessary because of its deterrent effect, whatever the objective evidence might be. As for those who say they support the discretionary death penalty, I think the argument they give is that circumstances differ. All right, there could be mitigating factors, aggravating factors, and so on and so forth. So my conclusion for this slide here is that, you know, DDP, discretionary, is greater than MDP, except for murder, all right? It's quite obvious from this table. Okay, I don't know whether I should just keep, okay, maybe I brief you on this slide as well, right? We actually have two different set of questionnaire, okay, RO1 and RO2, we call it that way. And the reason is that not everyone will be doing the same set of questionnaire, right? So to make sure that it's greater reliability and also to prevent response bias. Okay, so rotation is necessary. So half of the sample use rotation one and half use rotation two. And each rotation has three cases of murder, two cases of drug trafficking, and one case of firearms offense. So in other words, rotation one has six, rotation two has six, and altogether we have 12 scenario cases. Okay, and all cases were sentenced to death by the judge. So the question is, to what extent did our respondent concur with the judges? All right, this is a bit complicating, right? But I just want to point you to those that I've bowled, right? So for instance, okay, by the way, the six The 12 boxes are all there, right? Referring to the 12 cases. Let me just highlight what I'm bold. Like. I mean, no need to worry about the details. Okay, like for murder, for example, right? When it comes to mitigating factor, you find 52% will sentence the person to death. But when it comes to aggravating, it's 64. So actually, people are quite sensitive to whether it's mitigating or aggravating. So it's not like a one-size-fits-all kind of situation. Okay, what about drug trafficking, right? When it's aggravating, it's 47%. When it's mitigating, it's actually 17%, right? So note that all of these cases were sentenced to death by the judges, all right? But the respondents, only 17%, was sentenced the drug trafficker to death if there are mitigating factors. Okay, just talk about the implication, right? So the highest proportion was 64% as compared to 92% who supported death penalty for murder. Remember earlier I talked about 92% when we asked overall, right? But when it comes to actual cases with all the circumstances listed, you notice that it dropped down to 64. And also the other point I add here, but I don't have a table to show, is that 12% choose the death penalty for all cases they judge as compared to 100%. All right, so there are people, there are respondents who actually sentence every of these cases to death, but it's only 12%, okay, as compared to the judges who sentence 100% of them to death. So I think the second part is also the same, right? But right, for drug trafficking, okay, let me just highlight this part. 10% choose the death penalty for all cases they judge as compared to 100% for the judges. So 100 judges, 100%, but our respondent, only 10% will choose the death penalty for all the cases that they happen to judge, if they happen to be the judge. Let's move on, please. Okay, so topic four is, what if there is evidence to prove that death penalty is not a better deterrence than life? What if innocent people have in fact sometimes been executed? What if most countries have abolished a mandatory death penalty, leaving the decision to the judge? So these are several what-if questions we pose to the respondents. And let's see some of the results that we get. Okay, so what if death penalty is less of a deterrence? And so we get all these. Okay, generally in favor of death penalty for murder, earlier it was 92, right? But still in favor, if proven not a better deterrent than the life of long imprisonment, is 56. And still favor, even if proven innocent, people have been executed. So there are people who are quite diehards, okay? Even if it's innocent, people have been executed. Even if it's proven to be not deterrent, you still have diehards who say that they will. But it certainly dropped from 92% to 56 and 35. All right. So the point that we are trying to demonstrate here is that, I mean, it's not, it's a lot more nuanced, you see? And there's room for calibration rather than to say that, you know, that's it, mandatory. No question asked. All right. Similarly, for drug trafficking also, it drops when you give them these what-if questions. When we pose a what-if question to them. All right. So for drug trafficking, 83 dropped to 43 to 28 and 47 to 31. Yeah, next please. And the main reason for preferring the death penalty, in all cases you find that deterrence seems to be a key reason for choosing the death penalty. So of course the question here is, does death penalty has a deterrent effect in practice? I mean, this reflects the perception of respondent. All right, they think that it has a deterrent effect, but of course we need to prove whether does it really have a deterrent effect or not. All right, but the presumption is that there is. Okay, topic five, perceived effective alternative measures. So this is, I don't think we talk a lot about it, but some of the measures, alternative other than sentencing and all that is, do we need more effective policing, better moral education, more effective control, and some people say maybe more execution. Next, please. All right, these numbers don't add up to 100, but these numbers refers to the proportion who rank the policy measure as first choice. So you notice that actually a lot of the respondents think that better moral education would be helpful. All right, 56% for murder and 52% for drug trafficking. All right, and of course, there's a small minority who believe that more execution would be the solution to the problem. Okay, so implication, moral education is preferred. Death penalty, much less so. Next, please. Okay, this is probably my last topic already. I did a regression. I know sociologists like to do this, right? So I decided to do this, and I put in all these variables and see what happened. And what I get, okay, come next. Okay, what I get is, okay, this is what we call logistic regression, and this is the kind of results you get, right? Seniors age 66 or older, they are 1.8 times more likely than the young, all right, to support the death penalty. Okay, so old people more likely to support. I suppose our conjecture would be that they are more conservative. They believe that, you know, there's no room for rehabilitation, right? All right, number two, I think is quite interesting. Those with degree qualifications are 1.7 times more likely than those with primary or lower education to support the death penalty. I mean, a bit sort of paradoxical, right? We expect them to be more liberal, but they are not really, okay? They actually are more likely to support DP than those with primary or lower education. Among the, in terms of religion, right? Chinese religionists, all right, they are 2.3 times more likely than Protestant to support the death penalty. Okay, those who Python and consider themselves Taoists. Catholics, 2 times less likely than Protestants. Okay, next point is those who score high on religiosity, less likely to support the death penalty. All right, all kinds of religion. Those who are more religious, less likely to support the death penalty. And then I also did another regression, but I don't report the number here, and that is under the note, right? I also found that no significant difference between demographic categories in their preferred sentences in the 12 scenario cases. Perhaps the generic question solicits a knee-jerk response, while the 12 scenario cases solicit a considered response. Sorry. So my hypothesis here for the regression here is that, okay, this is my hypothesis on why the higher the educational level, the more likely to support the death penalty. I mean, you guys, many of you are probably in this category, right? So again, I would like some feedback on this. But this is just a hypothesis, right? Okay, I conjecture that middle class subscribe to the ideology of security and meritocracy. The former translate into stronger support for law and order. The latter into believing that one should get what one deserves, be it reward or punishment. So this is what I think is can be used to explain why the higher the education level, the more likely to support the death penalty. Okay, I think my last slide already. Okay, my conclusion here. So support for mandatory death penalty was much lower than might have been inferred from previous surveys with sought opinion about the death penalty in general. All right, so if you just use the first number that we had, 70%, it looks very high. Or the rich survey, 80%, very high. But the moment you ask them a lot more details, you find that it dropped down substantially. Okay, when placed in context, support for the death penalty, as shown by the scenario's decision, was weaker than often portrayed, in particular for drug trafficking and for firearms offences where no death or injury has occurred. So my last point here is, when asked if the DP should be abolished, following international trends, about 72% say no. My sense is that Singaporeans are more likely to support discretionary death penalty, less so for mandatory death penalty. Right, so I think that's what our findings show. I mean, it's nuanced, it's calibrated, but I think the support for death penalty is still there, except that they will prefer that it's discretionary rather than mandatory. Maybe I'll leave my personal opinion to the Q&A. Yeah. Thank you very much.